Good evening, beloved. Welcome to the Greater Hines Street Missionary Baptist Church Wednesday evening Bible study. We are so glad that all of our members, those who are able to join us, our preachers, pastors, and our friends and well-wishers across the country. And we trust that you all have a blessed 4th of July, that it was safe, safe travel, and safe arrival. Thank God for traveling grace. I thank Brother Jennings who carried on for us on last Wednesday. We just thank him for his able teaching, and we're going to somewhat recap chapter 2 so that we will get a fresh start in chapter 3. This is Paul's epistle to the young son in the ministry, Titus. As you know, we hear so much about Timothy. But Titus is a book, scholars feel, was written between 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy. So this is one of the epistles that was written in between chapter 1, 2, and 3 of Titus, was between chapter 1 and chapter 2, 1 Timothy, and 2 Timothy. So this kind of sandwich in between where he was writing to his young son, and in the ministry, not from his physical loins, but from his spiritual loins. We note that Titus, it was a Greek. We don't know much about him as we do from Timothy. So he's writing this to correct some of the errors that he was encountering, to bring order in the church. And because this was, it was written to this young preacher to deal with some of the false teachers. And of course, as we have already in our introductory remarks indicated to you that this was the island, the Greek island in the Mediterranean Sea, one of the largest ones. It was a Crete. Some argue that it was between 170. 170 miles north and south, as well as east and west. There may be some variations occasionally. But let's go into the Word of God, and then we'll talk more, you know, about his exhorting this young preacher. God, our Father, we thank you for this time of sharing. We pray as we study and we grow and we are enlarged, we'll not only be hearers and learners, but we'll also be doers. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your leading, your teaching. Thank you for your anointing on the message and messenger in these days, people. Guide our thoughts. Lead us now. And in the mighty name of Jesus, we pray that others will be blessed as a result of this teaching tonight. And perhaps the lives will be changed, and we'll have a better and a stronger and a closer walk with you. Is in the name of him who is our Christ we pray. Amen. All right. So then we find that he is writing to this young preacher. And he's encouraging him, as one writer put it, you can't be a people pleaser and being an effective minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You can't be. Some argue that you have to be thick-skinned it. But at the same time, have a tender heart. Thick-skinned, but have a tender heart. And sometimes that causes some problems. His name means honorable, Titus. That name means honorable. And here he's writing to establish order in the church, order in the church, and deal with many of the legalists who had been oftentimes following Paul around, that had dogged his ministry, teaching that circumcision was not enough, that to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior was not enough. They had required something else, and of course that's a false teaching. And Paul encouraged Titus to deal with this. You have to deal with it, lest false doctrine would creep into the church. And we encourage you to read meditatively so that you can make a decision, you know, for yourself with the aid of the Holy Spirit, because the preacher may not be around to give you the proper interpretation, and then you can distinguish between false teachers and the true teachers. Because if you get your doctrine straight, the duty will be straight, and then our profession, our walk, I will match your confession. Your walk and your talk will be consistent one with the other. So now he is writing down to straighten out some of the things in the church. Now he can't spend all of his time dealing with false teachers. There must be balance in the ministry, in this teaching. There must be balance. He couldn't spend all of his time dealing with false teachers. The teaching of the preacher, whatever the age may be, there must be balance in the teaching. And so what he's doing here now, going forward, is particularly in verses 1 and verse 2, he's dealing with this one group. Now, there are three groups that he's dealing with here, three groups of people in the church that he's exhorting to remind them of their obligation in the church. And that is the aged saints. They're the older saints in the church who's been around a while, that they should be sober. And he's talking about their qualifications. In Titus, they're about 12 or so. You can count it, perhaps 15 or so, in of conditions that they must have, qualifications in Timothy. And so, and oftentimes they tend to overlap one with the other. And so he is dealing with, early on, he's dealing with the aged saints. This is the older saints in the church who've been around a while and who they've been blessed to live a while. And so he's encouraging them to, since you've been around a while, you ought to be grave. You ought to have be vigilant. You should be temperate. You should have self-control. And other attributes, you read it. And so, but your spiritual health is more important than your physical health. Your physical, it is the spiritual aspect of it that will determine your reward and the quality of your life and your ability to help young preachers and help other young men and saints in the church of the living God. And so he's encouraging them to how to handle them in the church. And this is the message to the believers. He wants to preach, you have to preach sound doctrine. As we look at the first 10, we've already covered it, so I just want to give you a little recap here of it. He is to preach and teach sound doctrine. Because you have to have sound doctrine, you have sound faith, you have a sound walk. You have a sound deportment as you go through life. Because the behavior now of the old men, it should be an example of maturity and not be messy and keeping up some type of foolishness in the church. It should be an example of maturity, and it should show sound faith. Sound faith. That is the older one, the aged one in the church. And also, how you deal with the aged women of the church. It should be an example. They should be an example of holiness and reverence. Not be busybodies and keeping up stuff. You've heard it said over the years, nothing like a worse than an old hellion in the church. But we have to be sober to teach, and they should be able to teach the young women. Now, this is an aspect that Paul is encouraging him, that the older women should teach the young women in the church, but they have to walk a certain way for them to have the credibility with the young women and to have the respect of the young women. He's not encouraging Paul, but he's telling him that the older women should teach the younger women, because here he's a young minister, and as a result, particularly in today's culture, when pastors, young men can get caught up with some, even some rumor, it can affect your effectiveness, because this is what you have. You have your You have your influence. That's what you have. You have your word. You have your integrity. And when that's impugned, it affects your effectiveness in the church. So he's encouraging. He can encourage the older women to teach the young women, because there can be some missteps and certain things that said, whether or not there's any validity to it or not. But he's saying that the older women in the church, you all teach the young women. And he did not give, that's the group that he seemed to, but you have to walk that around them a certain way. But the teaching, he wants to leave that up to the aged women, that they should, and their behavior should become holiness in verse 3, and not false accusers, not even given to so much wine, and teachers of good things, no drunken woman. Now this is the island of Crete now. You know, the Cretans have this bad reputation of being liars and gluttonous and busybodies. They've got a bad reputation. There's a certain stereotype of the Cretans. And so they are to, the behavior of the young women is an example of purity to keep God's message from being slandered. Young women in the church, they are to teach the older, to teach young women to be sober, to love their husband, to love their children. As you know, it has been said time and time again that the hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. And so he encourages them, particularly in this day and age, and we have to be very, very careful, because we have so many women working outside of the home. They have professions outside of the home. And sometimes they're having to tread the wine press alone and to raise the children after the death of the husband, or for some reason or another, she's a single parent and having to deal with this. And so he's encouraged her to be discreet and to be, keepers of the homes and of good obedience to their own husband, that the word of God wouldn't be blasphemed, that if the word of God wouldn't be slandered. But the point, particularly in today's culture, in a contemporary society, it is, and many times, oftentimes they work out of the home in order to make ends meet, that it can, don't let outside interests override the welfare of the home and your children. Don't let outside interests compete and override cause your home to be in disarray because of the outside function of the home. And so the behavior, and so this is how we, otherwise you will make the word of God to none effect. It is tantamount to blaspheming and slandering the word of God, because this is what God has set up. This is God's word. This is how he has ordained it, so that there will be love and peace and harmony in the home and tranquility of the home, and that it would abide in the home. So this is how God has it set up. But then today's culture, the worldview, tend to counter this God's word, the spiritual view that is the word of God. So we have to be careful with that, even in today's culture, And so then he moves on to this next group, to the young men. Young men should likewise exhort to be sober-minded, because you have young men now, they have their different, they have ambition, they want to go and get it. They become sexually active at a certain period of time, and they are to practice self-control. Self-control in your pursuit, of happiness and the American dream. We are to be self-controlled, because so much is out there. There's so much competition is out there. And it appears in today's world, there's a crisis in the culture. We see shootings, we see terrorists, people have trying to have block parties, and then some, barbarian-like people just decide that they want to shoot up. People just trying to have a good, wholesome time. But then here comes, this has come from the pit of hell. This is that's the only way you can explain it, however you want to deal with it. This is from the pit of hell. This is a satanic force, because what has happened, their home is out of order. It is out of order. And as a result of the home being out of order, the culture is out of order. And as a result, the church is out of order. And as a result, there's a great falling away. We can see that in different religions and denominations. There's a great falling away from the church. Because the enemy, not necessarily outside the church, but has crept into the church. And it has affected so much. And now, even our children are not wanting to follow the path of the old. And if they're being driven away from the church, oftentimes because the adult walk is not lining up with their talk. The profession is not lining up. And so this is what he is establishing. God's order today in every aspect, in many aspects, there is a perversion of the word of God and the way he has designed the function, the orderliness that he has designed is being undermined by the world view. And because the devil is busy, because he knows his time is running out, and that he feels the feet of Jesus, because he knows his time is running out. And he stepped up his game. He's turned up the heat. And as a result, we can see so much. But the biblical prophecy is being fulfilled in our very time, in our very hour. And so, therefore, we need to be sober. We need to be into the word of God. Into the word of God. Because again, here again, the world will handle you. Society will handle you based on what is within you. If you say, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world, then the outside circumstances will keep you undaunted. That is, you will have something when the world comes to challenge and to crush you in. You will say, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. That is, that if we have the word in us, then the world can't do us any harm. It will, the enemy will fall, but they won't prevail. And so he's exhorting the young to be sober-minded, to be sober-minded. And he wants the servants now, the behavior of Christian workers. Many times, those who seek to take advantage of the scripture and take it out of context indicated that it's a justification for slavery. And we're looking at
verse 9, exalt the
servants to be obedient unto their own masters and to please them well in all things, not answering again. And many times this has been used as a justification for slavery. But what it does is a leveling field. At the cross, the ground is level. It puts the believers on the same level, whether or not you're a master or you are of the servant. And we have to look at first century Roman Empire. There were many slaves there as a result of one nation conquering another nation, and a larger nation taking advantage of weaker nation. And as a result, they made them slaves when there was a conquering, when there was a war. And those with the spoils of the war would take those person and make them slaves as a result. This is not the slavery that we know it as, which is a scar on America from that type of slavery, but it was used to justify it. But here it is within the context of a person could sell themselves into slavery as a result of getting in debt. become an indentured servant, and then you would have to become a slave until you work yourself out of debt. And so, some argue that historians that there were approximately 60 million slaves, or 6 million slaves, there are different numbers, within the Roman Empire itself. Maybe 5, 10, 15% of the population was slavery. So he is saying this is a master employer-employee relationship. In other words, this is how you behave. That not prolonging, not showing all good fidelity, that they may adorn the doctrine of God, our Savior, in order. This is just teaching on how you can behave yourself in an employer-employee relationship. And so in so doing, you will not make the word of God of none effect. So we have to, some would use that, you know, for a wrong purpose. It was the behavior of the Christian slave, our workman. And what he's saying here, in those days there were these millions of slaves, but there were slave owners, and government would have attacked the church, its preachers and believers, seeking to destroy such a doctrine. Imprisoned the slave owners now, and the government, that would abuse this to their advantage. And so as a result, he's telling them that when the slave and the master come together, they come together at a leveling ground. It's a leveling place where we are here as brothers in Christ, because there's no Jew nor Gentile, no master or slave, no male or female at the foot of the cross. We all are one in essence in Christ. It makes us all sisters and brothers in Christ. And so this deal with workmen have the proper attitude and not to take advantage one with the other. And so when we look at 11 through 15, this is the grace. This deal with the grace of God. This deal with the grace of God. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men, whosoever will let him come. No selected grace. This is grace for you, grace for someone else, or grace for just us and not y'all. But this is grace of God. It brings salvation to all men. To all men. Grace. The most meaningful word in the language of men is grace. The Bible means something far more than men mean by grace. It's more than what men mean by grace. The men, the word of grace means three things. Grace is that something, yes, is that something, that quality within the thing that is beautiful or joyful. It may be fragrance of a flower, the rich green of the grass, and the beauty of a lovely person. Grace is anything that has loveliness. It may be thought as an act, a word, a person. Grace is a gift, a favor that someone might extend to a friend. Worldly view of grace. The favor is always freely done, expecting nothing in return, and the favor is always done for a friend, because the friend can reciprocate. All right. But then, however, when we look at it from God's perspective, it's what God has done for men that they had to add a deeper and a much richer meaning to the word of grace from God. For God had saved sinners those who had acted against him while we were yet enemies of his. He died, Christ died for us. Therefore, grace became the favor of God that showered upon men, men who did not deserve his favor. Grace became the kindness and the love that God freely gives to his enemies, men who were without strength, men who were ungodly, men who were sinners, men who were enemies of his.
And he gave us, for God
so loved the world. You see it all along the road in ballpark, for God so loved the world. John 3:16, the most popular verse that even the sinners can quote it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. It's a gift. It's a gift.
It's a gift that God has given us. Look at what Ephesians
2:8-9 says. For by grace are ye saved by faith now, by faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So we don't bring anything to the salvation table. We bring nothing. We just bring brokenness. We're no more than a filthy rag. It's a gift because we don't have anything to boast about, because we didn't bring anything. We can't be good enough. We can't do enough. And this was the problem with law. They tried to do. Nicodemus asked Jesus in John 3, what must I do? What did they ask Paul in the Philippian jail? What must I do to be saved? It's not anything that you do. It's what you accept in your heart. It's not what you do. You can't do enough. You can't be good enough. You can't.
It's a free gift of God.
That's what it's all about. And so, my beloved, God's grace is a free gift. It's a free gift of God, and it extends his grace toward men. In Romans 3:24, being justified freely by his grace through redemption that is in Christ Jesus. So we are bought with the price. Bought with the price. And so when we look at the grace of his teaching
us that,
in verse 12, that denying ungodliness and worldliness, lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. And so this is what the grace does. And look at verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men. Looking, verse 13, looking for that blessed hope, the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and his glorious appearing of that great God and our Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ. So what does the grace of God teach us? It teaches us to look for the return of the great God, even our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So we're looking for his coming back. That's what grace does. It teaches us to look. That's that hope that we have to defend within us. That's that hope within us. And the grace of God is demonstrated in the death of Christ. What did he do with the death of Christ? Did he pay that price to redeem us? We were on the slave block of sin. And he came and redeemed us. He redeemed us and set us apart as a special people, a peculiar people, because we are redeemed. We are his property. We are bought with a price. We are bought with a price. We don't belong to ourselves. We belong to another. We are part of a kingdom. We're part of a kingdom. We have dual citizenship, our earthly citizenship, but we have a heavenly citizenship. And the rules are different. The laws are different. The behavior is different. So we have the duality of ourselves, a dual personality. Citizens of the earth, but we're also citizens of heaven. And whenever there's a conflict between, and we'll get into that in the final chapter here, chapter 3, we are set apart, we're peculiar people, and it to inspire us to good work, not because we're saved by work, but to do good work. We work because we're saved. That's why we do what we do at our church and ministry and blessing, release the lost and lift out those who have those who've been marginalized, because that's what his job description was. I came. He is anointed to preach the gospel to the poor.
And those who are in
prison.
Declare the day
of Jubilee.
That's what he does.
And so these grace men, the grace of God is a message to proclaim through the preaching.
And exhorting.
Of reproof. That's what he does. What is that grace? Is that unmerited favor. That unmerited favor of God. What does grace, what does the grace of God mean? Among men, grace means the favor and blessing that one person bestows upon another person. But God's grace means something far more. God's grace is the grace that brings salvation to man. God's grace is Jesus Christ, the gift of the Savior to the world. God's grace, that unmerited favor.
Sinners, he died for us.
And so, my sisters and brothers, when we look at the compass, we have one man, Romans 5:12. Romans 5:12, wherefore, as by one man sin into the world, and death by sin, and so death passes upon all men, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 5:12. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin
is death. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God
is eternal life. And as a result, look what his grace did for us. In Hebrews 9:27, it brought death to us, because it is appointed unto men once to die. And it is appointed to men once to die. And after that, the judgment. And so that's what we must stand on. If we come short of God's glory, and that we have violated the law of heaven and are doomed to prison. Look at these three reasons why we do not deserve God's grace. Number one, because we come short of his glory in that we've sinned.
And secondly, we come
short of God's glory in that we die. And then thirdly, we come short of God's glory in that we have violated the law of heaven and are doomed to prison and judgment of hell. But that's why Jesus came, to redeem us. It was God's grace.
His grace. Matthew 10:20.
And the fear of them that which killed the body, but not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both the body and the soul. And so we have, this is the good news. This is the good news. Luke 3:6, that all flesh shall see the salvation of God when you believe in him. When you believe
in him. And so my sisters and brothers, as we leave this
chapter, let us stand on the word of God. For he's on his way back. He's on his way back. I want to leave this with you. Jesus is on his way back. There will be this glorious reunion, and we will have this glorified body. So we look in hope. We look in hope. In verse 14, we see
that the grace of God is
revealed in the death
of our Lord and
Savior Jesus Christ.
And And finally, the grace of God is
to be proclaimed. It is to be
proclaimed in three ways. Three ways we are to speak
for the grace of God, preach, teach,
and bear witness.
Let your life bear witness. Let your
life bear witness.
And then secondly, we are to exhort people in the grace of God. That is, we are to encourage.
Be an encourager. Be an exhorter.
Encourage somebody. Because people are lonely. So many people are empty. People are without purpose. They're discouraged. They're distressed. And too many are without hope. Leave tonight. Be an encourager.
Be an encourager to be able to help someone. That's
our purpose. We're not containers. We are conduits. We are channels of his blessing, what he's blessed us with. Those of us studying tonight, there may be others who may not be on the line. But you can be an encourager.
How many can you can reach? You don't have to worry about,
you know, the result. Just plant the seed.
Just plant the seed. Plant the seed. Apollo watered.
God grants the increase. And then thirdly, we are to rebuke people in
the grace of God.
In the grace of God. There is no excuse for men rejecting the grace of God in their sin. God has done so much for us in his son Jesus Christ. Luke 17:3.
Take heed to yourselves. If thy brother
trespass against thee, rebuke him.
And if he repent, forgive him. Ephesians 5:11.
Be ye therefore followers of God as their children. 1 Timothy 5:20, them that sin, rebuke them before all, and others that also may fear. 2 Timothy 4:2, preach the word, be instant in season.
With your life out of season.
Reprove, rebuke, exalt with all long suffering and doctrine. Titus 2:5, to be discreet, chaste.
Keep us at home.
Good, obedient to their own husband and word of God, to be not blasphemed.
Thank you for joining us. We look
forward to next Wednesday, if it's the Lord's will, Titus chapter 3. God bless. Father God, we thank you for this time of sharing. We thank you for those who joined us. We pray that you will just
keep us and use us, oh God, in these last and evil days. Use us as witnesses, as tools, as encouragers, oh God, that we may, that men
can see how good we're and will glorify you. Oh God, help us to be that salt. Help us to be that light in this dark world. Bless us now as we go forward. In the name of him who is our Christ, we pray.